my best friends in the ministry. We would go into, there was a period of time we traveled into other countries. They would not let him into Canada because his rap sheet, the history on him, they started printing it off when we got into the, and they wouldn't let him in. He is former pimp, used to run all kind of game. But his passion for God, he reached so many people for God. God used that same, those gifts and callings that he used in the streets. God took and used that to reach many people. Turn to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. This is where it becomes personal, and I want to just break this down a little bit for you this morning. Years and years and years, I struggled trying to be something that I wasn't in the church. Yeah. Trying to dress how I thought people wanted me to dress, talk the way people wanted me to talk, you know, play the part. And guess what? God's got a part for you to play. It's your part. And it's different from the person next to you. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. The Apostle Paul is talking about motivational gifts. For I say through the grace given to me, everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function. Circle that, one body. We're one. So we being many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. Let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. If ministry, let it use it to our ministry. He who teaches in teaching. He who exhorts in exhortation. He who gives with liberality. He who leads with diligence. He who shows mercy with cheerfulness. A friend of mine, Tim Walterbach, was one of a builder here in town for years and years. Built million-dollar homes. When the market went down, he had like 10 homes on the market that were each worth about $1 million, and his business ended up going under. But this man taught me, I watched his life, how he used his gifts. He wasn't doing what he did in the church. But this man, let me tell you what he would do. He would get a contract to build a house or to renovate a house. And then he had, most of his crew were guys that had just gotten out of prison. And then he had guys that were crew chiefs over painting and over electrical and over different parts of this build out that had the same background as these guys. These guys had a heart to minister to these guys. And if any of you have been in the construction business, you know there's a lot of drug abuse and things like that go on the work site. But Tim had a completely drug-free work site. In fact, there were times I visited the work site and these guys would be praying one for another on their breaks. People would be getting healed. People would be getting saved. And you're sitting looking at this million-dollar church house and you're seeing church happening at the work site. Then we had an opportunity to renovate. There was a lady here in the community that her house had gotten burned during the ice storm, and he got all his crews to come and help, and we raised about almost $100,000 worth of materials and labor, and they completely did an extreme makeover on her house. And this is what I saw. This is what I saw happen. What happened never happened inside the church building. Never happened in the church building, Pastor. I saw people coming to the work site that weren't even saved, that started working and helping, and by the end of that 3-week period, it was during Thanksgiving, people were getting saved. People were getting, I mean, I'm talking about real healing. I mean, a guy had Hep C, hepatitis C. He went, got checked after they prayed for him. He didn't have it anymore. I mean, miracles happening on the job site. And I watched these guys, diversity of gifting. Some of them were electricians. Some of them we had a company that came and put on the roof. We had different people come in and putting in wood floors and bathroom fixtures and things like that. But at the end of the day, church happened. and the job got done. And from the gifts of one person multiplied between a whole group of people, God got glory. This is the heart, I believe, of what the Lord wanted me to share with you this morning, is that many of you in this room, God wants you to find your flow. See, there's one thing, Rob, I don't know why I'm picking on you, Rob, but you know what I'm talking about. But when you get your flow, things are flowing. When you're an athlete and you know when you're on, you're on. Most preachers know when they're preaching and they're on, they know it. You can tell the head will start. Yeah. And that flame on the inside of you. You know, my oven went out a couple months ago and the valve was broken. And as much as I tried to get that thing to go, the gas was not flowing and that flame was not going to happen. I could put all the sparks down there I wanted, but there was no flow. It was blocked. And for many in this church, I believe God wants you to find your flow. Find the place. Find the area. This is what Joel did in Acts 2. I'm not going to keep going on it, but in Acts 2, it is a prophecy in Joel chapter 2. In the last days, sons and daughters will prophesy. Men, women, both. Wasn't limited to men. Sons and daughters prophesying. But in Joel, further down, that same portion of scripture says that there'll be an army. And each one will run in their own lane, and it says they'll not jostle each other. What am I saying? That it's a picture of the church, of people finding their flow, knowing what they're called to do. If you're supposed to be here at 9 o'clock, you're here at 8:50. If you know that your responsibility, God's put a heart on you to make this building everything that it needs to make, man, you're getting folks in here to do all kinds of stuff, to work on stuff. If you're called to reach out to children, you're beginning to put things together for the kids, whatever your flow is. But let me tell you something, the flow comes from the Holy Ghost. Him putting the love of God in your heart. You know, a couple of years ago, my wife and I were going through a hard time. And I was in that place of trying to find my flow. I was trying to, you know, I'd worked in the church most of my life. I was trying to find my flow. I was frustrated, yelling at the kids. Be quiet! Hollering at them, get home. Just frustrated. Shoot. Talk about Diary of an Angry Black Woman. How about an angry Chinese man? I'm not Chinese, I'm Korean, but I was mad. I was mad at myself, I was mad at God, I was frustrated. I kept my religious face on, but I was frustrated. God, why haven't you done this? Why haven't you done that? God began to deal with me about Romans 12. Son, what is it that motivates you? I've made you, you need to do something. And this morning, I believe the Holy Spirit's beginning to talk, begin to take your pen out and begin to write the words, the things that you know, that you know, that you know God has put upon your heart to do. There's some people in this room that the gifts and the callings have been dormant. I'm not going to go there, but 2 Timothy 1, verse 6, Paul told Timothy, said, stir the gift that is in you, fan into flame the gift of God that is in you through the laying on of my hands. God has not given you a spirit of fear, but love, power, and a sound mind. Why do we not step out? Because we're scared. We fear failure. I love that quote, that poem in Aquila and the Bee. We fear that we are actually marvelous. We fear success. Oh, I had to get that thing worked out in me. I'm telling you. I feared success. And God says this morning, as the Lord gives it to you, write it down. I'm talking to everybody here. There's some things that you know God has called you to do and to be, and it will be a witness Remember Nehemiah when he was rebuilding the wall? Those guys weren't church boys. They were carpenters. What could God do with a life that got in the flow of what they were created to do? And I want to tell you, you're never too old to find your flow. The power of one person finding their flow and allowing the fire of God to move in you. I've seen young people come from families. No one's ever gone to college. No one's ever, but they found their flow. They went to college, got 2 degrees, and are making more, 10 times the money than I've ever made. Kids that came from neighborhoods where no one did anything. They found their flow. And it's based on faith. God, if I really step out, if I really allow you to shake me like he did in Acts 4 and get me out of my rut, would you stand together this morning? I mean, there is such a prophetic mandate upon this church. What do I mean by that? God has a plan. God has a plan for your life. And how dare we be second best and mediocre when the King of Kings died for us to have all the victory, all the power, all the might this morning. I want you to lift your hands this morning. I want to ask you respectfully to do that. And it's really not where we are or who we're standing next to, it's who we're raising our hands to this morning. He is God. I'm telling you, he's real this morning. And this morning, if you lift your gifts to him like that boy with the loaves and fishes. I know you've had this business for years and years, and just like Peter, Jesus said, let down your net one more time. And the Bible says that when they let down that one more time, the amount of fish they brought in, they had to call their partners because they couldn't fit enough in the boat. God might be calling you to go to college. God might be calling you to serve in some area of this church. God may be calling you to begin to work with young people, or maybe it's women that are struggling. You have a ministry to hurting women or a ministry to men. But this morning, I thank him for the fire this morning, the fire. And it's not something mystical this morning. It is something real. And that fire will penetrate Kimash Didodoshai Timaha, even your marriage, Korasti Kiriande, for it is the picture of Christ in the church. And it is the primary area of your life, Kirashti Mai Kondrashta, that the enemy has tried to attack. But Jesus says this morning, I have prayed for you that your faith would fail not. And I hear conversations in the spirit that you've never had, men sharing, women sharing in relationships, intimacy, vulnerability, transparency. It's a picture of Christ in the church, where you take off your mask. You quit trying to fake the funk and you say, Lord, I'm a mess. Right here, I'm a mess. The wonderful thing about him is he meets us right past our fault and goes right to our need this morning. And I mean this morning by faith, as you're lifting your hands, you're not only releasing the burdens and the worries and the struggles and those specific things. And I'm talking about things that have, you know, have held you back for years and even decades from your full potential in Christ. And I want you now to begin to receive that grace this morning and ask him to do that.
Lord have come.
And you can test him. You can ask him. He said, ask, seek, and knock, and the door will be opened. And how does this apply to your life? I'm saying this morning, whatever you're dealing with, say, Lord, show up and show out. Right here. Right here. Now. David said it like this in Psalm 51. He had failed miserably and he had committed adultery and had done a bunch of mess. And he said, forgive me, wash me with hyssop, I'll be clean. Wash me, cleanse me. And he said, then I will teach transgressors your way. There was a lifting of his junk to God. And then he said, then. What is your then this morning? I'm telling you, some God's going to begin to talk to many of you. That flow is going to be opened up. That flow of the Holy Ghost is going to be opened up in you this weekend. You're going to break out of the box. And you're going to do what thus saith the Lord. For what in your own mind limited you, God says, I've released you to do and to be what I've called you to be in the fullness. In the name of Jesus. God, I thank you this morning. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you for this brother right here. I thank you, Lord. Grace upon this brother. The great grace, that same grace that was on the church in Acts. Let it come upon him and his wife. God, let it come upon their children. And let this not be some pretty prayer in church. But God, meet him where he's at. God, cause the walls to be busted out in the name of Jesus. Cause him to see the salvation of the Lord in the land of the living. My God, I thank you that what I see in their future, Lord, is more than they could ever ask or think or even imagine. Then God caused them to align themselves. Brother, God's causing an alignment. There's some adjusting. Who you align yourself with is so important. God says he's adjusting your alignments. He's adjusting who you're hooked up with. He's adjusting what you're doing when you're hooked up. God says, I've got some higher callings for you. Ah, la mashte bahandele bobo shata makiya shandorobrokoyanda. Repandele shubele. And let healing flow. Ah, I see you speaking the word of the Lord strong. That's what they did in Acts 4. They spoke the word with boldness. I see you speaking it over your wife. I see you speaking it over your kids. I see you speaking it over the affairs of your household. I see you speaking it over your ministry. I see you speaking it, speaking it, speaking it, speaking it, speaking it. In the name of the Lord. Thank you, Father. For you two this morning, would you guys take hands? I don't want to, but there is a greater potential. And where there has been a glass ceiling, I declare now this morning that the limitations are removed this year. As you go into 2012, you mark my words. In particular, there's going to be two opportunities that come to you, my brother. Where in the past, you would look on the outward of the opportunities, but God said, you're going to know and discern by the Spirit which direction to go. Yes, there's some things in your heart that have been greater than what you've even wanted to verbalize with other people. And it's because of the kingdom. It's because of souls. God says, I'm going to put you in a position to be a mouthpiece. Oh, my God. And it's because of the frustration in your soul, God said, it's almost been like you felt like you're spinning your wheels, but God says this morning, you're going to get traction. It's like when you put sand under the tires of a car when there's ice and snow. You're going to begin to get traction. Oh my God. I thank you for this relationship, this marriage, this family, that you have called them for such a time as this. You know, darkness of broadcast media to be a light and to be salt. Even in the athletic world, Lord God, I thank you for the grace upon them. And strengthening those things that remain, I thank you for the foundation of the world. You have made them strong. But God, in this season, they'll be strong in the Lord and the power of the Spirit. You all are to pray in the Spirit together, to pray in the Spirit together. And God, you watch things begin to unravel in the name of Jesus. It was prophetic this morning that before the service there was a wedding. Very prophetic this morning, Pastor. The sign of new beginnings. And sometimes when I prophesy before encouragement, I have to battle my own limitation, even in my own mind, who I am in my own flesh. But as you guys take hands, these past 50 years, you have sown and you have labored and you have battled and you have persevered. And you have studied to show yourself approved. And you have been faithful. Sometimes in the little. And God said, I hear it just like the clicking of a door closing. It's like the old season is just closed. And there's a door opening. The only way I can describe it is if you've ever seen The Matrix. One door closes and another one opens. Can you imagine an African-American woman wrote The Matrix? And after the movie made all the money, she's going to get a hundreds of million dollar settlement because they stole her story. I say that prophetically to you all. There have been situations in ministry where things have been stolen. And you have held your peace. And you have not lashed out, and you have not gotten bitter, and you have not gone on a witch hunt. And God said, now in this season, there is coming rain. I hear it. I hear the abundance of, I just hear it right now. Rain. 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 And rain always represents now the flourishing of seeds that have been planted. And there is coming a flourishing. And it's not something you have to do. When the rain comes, it just begins to flourish. The church is going to begin to look like what you envisioned, but in a different way. And there are going to be some things that come through here that you're going to be like, oh my God, I saw it, but I didn't see it like that. And people are coming from the north, south, east, and west. We prayed on Thursday. They're coming from the north, south, east, and west. Why? Because Hebrews 11, chapter 1, chapter 2, there needs to be, they need to be in a place where the elders found a good report. There is a good report standing right here. See, it's not how flashy you are. It's not how big your building is and how many staff you have. It's the good report. That you don't have to worry when you go home tonight if he's out in the street doing a bunch of mess. Your pastor and his wife are people of integrity. And upon that rock, he's going to build this church. Some of you are entering into a place of aggressive warfare.
aggressive intercession. I mean, you sat back and said, okay, I'll just, you know, now it's, Lord, we take it in the name of Jesus. Reach out your hand and say, I take it in the name of Jesus. Not for myself, but for the kingdom of heaven. I take it in the name of Jesus. I take what is mine in Jesus. What Jesus took nails in his hands and his feet, he bought for me. I take it in Jesus' name. Jesus sent his disciple and said, go get the donkey. And they said, well, what are we going to tell them? The Lord has need of it. Just take it. Just grab it. And some of you, I'm talking about in the spirit. I'm not saying stealing, going and taking somebody's car and getting in and the Lord has need of it. I'm saying in the spirit. I'm saying in your prayer life, I take that back. I take my confidence back. I take my checkbook back where I have been spending out of control. I take back self-control now, Jesus. Where I have been speaking all kind of crazy mess to my husband and my wife. I take back my mouth now, Jesus. I take it back. I mean, right now I hear it like just popping all around this building. It's like things are, heavens are being opened up over addresses all around this room. And if you just lift your hands, this is not some weird thing. Just lift your hand and say, God, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. Some of you, God's going to cause you like me to begin taking walks. And you're just going to walk and say, God, I thank you. The battle is not yours, but it's his. He told, oh my God, the children of Israel, when you hear the rustling in the mulberry tree, you know that my army has come and give you the victory. And you're going to hear God begin to move. You're going to see him. Not in the sweet by and by, but you're going to begin to see him in the name of Jesus. A couple things I want to prophesy. There's going to begin to be media that comes out of this church. They're going to begin to, brother, this is just the beginning with the video. There's going to begin to be media. It's not going to be something that you're going to have to worry about. But these services are going to begin to be broadcast. And people are going to begin to come for Jesus. Because of him. He's going to use the tool of media. He's going to use the internet. He's going to begin to bring young people, college age, high school. I saw a vision two months ago. I shared it with Derek. I saw this room full of young people. You're not to give up on the development of this land. You're not to give up on what you saw. You're not to give up on it in the name of Jesus. I saw you getting favor with business people in this city. You're going to have to battle some jealousy in the next few years, Pastor, because God's going to give favor with some people because of the good report. You have obtained it, sir. I would like to ask y'all, this is, if I may, I would like to ask them to come and surround you all. No one touching them, but just come, the church surround you all. Just for a moment, I don't want to drag this out. If you all would just surround, if you would come up. If you all would just stand here, and if the church would just surround you all, you can face this way, Pastor. Yes. Surround them. Where do we have elders here? Do we have elders or other appointed elders? I'd like for them to come and lay hands on you, surround you, and the people surround them. Come boldly, leadership. Come boldly and lay hands on them. And then everyone else come around. Father, we just begin to pray in the Spirit. Begin to pray in the Spirit. Begin to pray in the Spirit. We're calling those things that are not as though they were in the Spirit. Begin to pray in the Spirit. Begin to pray in the Spirit. Begin to pray in the Spirit. How beautiful are the feet of them that bring good news. For your heart for this community. Your heart for the people of this community. God is going to anoint the good news going forth out of this church. And what you have sown in the lives of others now springs forth. diversity of ministries. I mean, you're not going to be able to keep up with them and start coming and saying, "Pastor, I feel led to do this." And you're not going to have to worry about the money that people are going to begin to resource for themselves. And there is a release of blessing and generosity and diversity in this church. People that have got a heart to give. See, Pastor, I ran into a nurse at the hospital one day. She said, I haven't found a church that I even trust, so I give to John 3:16. We don't even go to church. I don't even think they were saved. But I see the good report of John 3:16, so I send a check every month. There are going to be people like that. Somehow, they're going to get a hold of Northside Christian Center, and they're going to begin supporting them. Like the woman that sold purple cloth in the New Testament, like the women that supported Jesus' ministry, they're going to begin to follow and support. Not because of some fancy telethon, but because the Lord connected you all in the name of Jesus. Just begin to say, we call it forth, we call it forth, we call it forth, we call it forth. Service is exactly what it pertains to. The last verse in Acts chapter 2 says that they ate food with gladness. What's happened? Why do people not come to church? 30% of this. The people of God have become some stuck in the mud. Don't hang out, don't eat, don't fellowship. And you are going to be known in the coming days for fellowship and food. I mean, I know we're a fasting church. And I mean, we're a healthy church too. I mean, I've got to qualify that a little bit. But this is going to be a church. I see relationships deepening. Yeah. I see relationships deepening, and I see relationships being formed amongst the people, amongst the men, amongst the women. Going fishing, hanging out, doing things, just being real, being real. I keep getting this picture of men and women, women ministering to young women, men ministering to young men. I see almost like a mentoring that is going to begin to happen. And some of you, it's been in your heart, and you're going to take leadership, and you're not going to take no for an answer now. It's not going to be this thing where you're going to write it down, you're going to follow through, you're going to get some brothers, you're going to get some sisters, and you're going to begin to follow through in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. And so, Father, we pray for this meal that we're going to receive this afternoon with gladness. We receive the food. And God, we celebrate the faithfulness and the good report of this man of God. And God, I thank you that we're not just in one place, but we're one. Come on, say it together. We're one. Say it again. We're one. One team. One accord. One church. In Christ. In Jesus' name. Somebody in the pastor.
Praise Lord. Glory. Glory. God bless you. You may take just momentarily. Just to call.